I'm a big fan of cubes. I love Rubik's cubes and I love the geometry of cubes. And when I did a lecture at their institution several years ago, when I was looking at the fourth dimension, I showed how you can take a 3D cube and unfold it into a 2D net. And because we live in 3D reality, I can actually do that. So there's a model of that net and you can see it folds up and around the 3D cube and you can unfold it. It's a nice way to go down a dimension, which is why I was showing this, because if you go a dimension higher, you can get a 4D cube and unfold it into a 3D net. We're not going to go into all the details of how that actually works, partly because you can watch that lecture, and partly because as humans, we just haven't got any kind of visual intuition of how the fourth dimension works. And so don't panic if it doesn't make absolute clear sense. It doesn't make sense to anyone. But the moral of the story is, you can take a higher dimension cube and bring it down a dimension by unfolding it. What I specifically want to look at today is, well, I always use this stereotypical kind of cross-shaped net, but there are loads of other ones. So for example, there's this one. It's got like a Z or something. That one works perfectly well. In fact, what else have I got here? Here we go, there's this one. That's got different shape again. That one works. And so our first question is really, how many of these are there? And then secondly, how many of those are there? For the record, Jane Street don't support these videos just because they like mathematics, although that's true. They also want more mathematicians in the world so they can hire them. I'll have details about what it's like to work at Jane Street and their paid internships at the end of the video. However, what we're actually here for is if you've got six squares arranged in such a way that they can cover a cube, how many options do you have for ways to arrange those squares in distinct ways? I mean, how many can there be? Ah, 11? Question now is, what is the logic behind these? Some of these are obvious because there's the classic where you got the bottom and then the four sides come up and the lid. But if you've got this band that goes around the cube, you can put these two anywhere. So there's the same thing, but they've been moved. So they still just fold in from different directions. That works. That's the same idea as that. There's another one, the same idea, that one, and this one. They're all the same concept. But then how would we account for ones like this, where you haven't got the run of four like you do in those. There's like three, but then that folds in there. Likewise, this one does roughly the same thing. And that's similar. But then there's these crazy ones. Two lots of three. Who saw that coming? And then one goes around that way. Then one goes around that way. A bit like a tennis ball. Maybe that's obvious to other people. And then my personal favorite, what kind of zigzag is this? And you start there and it just kind of goes that way and then that way and then that way, boom, perfect. We need a systematic way that we could have calculated or deduced what all of these are and know for certain we didn't miss any. Step one, we're going to represent our cube with a graph, aka a network where each of the nodes represent the different faces and then the edges show you where the faces are joined. And so currently each face is joined to the four other ones around it. And the process of turning this 3D cube into a net is just the process of cutting those edges. So if you cut these three here, that unfolds and we've reduced our graph a little bit. You could then cut this edge and this edge, that unfolds, would cut that one, and there we are. So we've gone from the 3D cube to the flat net, which has also reduced our graph to what is called a tree graph, because everything branches, there's nothing that loops back. And all of these will give us a six node tree graph, which means they'll be joined by five edges. And actually, if you check these, there's always five joining points. However, there are exactly six node tree graphs. And we've got 11 of these because there's an extra condition. These don't automatically give us one of these. The extra problem is you need pairs of faces that have one between them. And the geometric reason for that is if you've got opposite faces, they have to be linked by one face in between. And so that's true of every one of these. You can divide this into pairs of faces that end up opposite each other. So what you do is you take one of these tree graphs, let's use the straight line one, and you find a way to match up the nodes into pairs such that each pair has one other node between them. And that represents this one. So it's showing you that the end one and then the one, two in, they end up opposite, which is true, like that. And then likewise, this end one and that one, two in, they're opposite. And then the remaining ones, these ones here are opposite, and you can see that's those ones there. Ah, okay, in this case, there's two, sorry. One or more. There needs to be one or more in between the opposite pairs. So in this case, there's one there, and then it goes across, and then there's the other one. So you need to have three pairs, none of which... You need to have three pairs where none of the pairs are adjacent nodes already joined by an edge. That works. So for this straight line, there are actually four ways of doing it. And so they correspond to four of these. Specifically, this one. This one. That crazy one, that's one of them. And, this one. Okay, so these are the all four where they just form a continuous line if you look at the linking, because the graph doesn't give us any like the geometry. It just shows us how they link. These other ones have ones that come off on the side. So you can see this one matches up with that one. And if you take all six of the six node tree graphs, this one has four, next one has three, one of them has two, the last two have one each, and the final one, the star one, has zero, because that middle node has an edge to every other one, and so it can't become a net. And it turns out that property of having the three pairs, none of which are adjacent, is both necessary and sufficient. So as long as we've found that condition on one of these tree graphs, we know we definitely get a net. And by going through systematically like this, we can prove there are precisely 11. Fun side fact, every single one of these 11 nets perfectly tile the plane. So you can pick any one of them and you can repeat it to perfectly cover a surface. Isn't that amazing? Anyway, enough about 2D nets. We've got higher dimensions to deal with. Just like a 3D cube is made of six 2D squares, a 4D cube is made of eight 3D cubes. So once it's unfolded into a net, we should see all eight of them joined together, one face each, into some kind of octocube, technically. And if you look at all the tree graphs which have eight nodes, there are 23 of them. So all we have to do is take all 23 of those graphs and count how many ways there are to split them into four pairs such that each pair, the nodes are not adjacent. And we count those up and we'll have the number of 3D nets of a 4D cube. And how many can there be? Ah! Ah! Oh my. Okay. Oh! Okay. So it turns out 261. There are 261. Of course the pattern goes 1, 11, because there's only one 1D net of a 2D square. 1, 11, 261. Classic combinatorics. And don't waste too much of your valuable brain time trying to imagine how these fold into a 4D cube, because like when you have the dimension lower one, where's my net gone? Here we go. When you've got a 2D net, like when that folds into a cube, the folds happen in the orthogonal extra dimension. They have to come up into 3D. And so for these to fold, they fold in the fourth dimension. So we unfortunately can't process that. But just enjoy the fact that we know these are the 200, we genuinely made all 261. By the way, sitting here is like being in some kind of Tetris-induced fever dream. The question of how many of these 3D nets there are was first asked in 1966 by Martin Gardner, but it wasn't answered until nearly two decades later, in 1985, by someone called Peter turny, and the reason it took so long is calculating how many ways you can choose those pairs for each of those 23 networks is incredibly hard work. And computing power basically had to catch up before Peter was able to do the calculation. And in their paper, which I love, at the very bottom, they do mention what would come next. They say, there are 106 10-node trees. I have not determined how many ways they can be paired. An exhaustive examination of the possibilities will probably require a significant amount of computer time. Spoiler, it did. But for now, we're going to take a bit of a closer look at these, particularly this one, because this one is my new favorite 3D net of a 4D cube, because I found how this one can tile 3D space. If all of the 11 nets of a 3D cube tile 2D space, the obvious question now is, how many of the nets of a 4D cube tile 3D space? And a paper was published in 2015. Two people, Joseph O'Rourke and Giovanna Diaz, found, well, there was a discussion on Math Overflow and someone pointed out that they'd found two of these that can repeat and, you know, perfectly fill space with no gaps. They found this one, which looks like, it's like two fours joined together, and they found this one, and they showed that you can repeat these over and over again. They fit together nicely. Joseph and Giovanna found two more. They did the classic, I call this the Dali cross, because of that famous painting that Dali did. And this one was not as straightforward as these ones. These ones are reasonably easy. This one was reasonably tricky. I'll show you it in a moment. They also found one more, but I forgot to take it out when we were hanging all of these up. And so in here somewhere is another one. Which one was it? It's number, give me a, let's have a look here. Number 73, 073. I'm sure the moment I look at this video afterwards, I will spot it. It's a bit like that one, but the L's are the other way around. Ah, I'll find it later. So they found two more. And then I got excited and I found this one. But let me show you how this works. All right, I'm just gonna get rid of these for a second. And these, don't worry, they'll be back. And if you want one of these, details later on. Here I have representatives from the three rounds of discovery of which of these ridiculous 3D nets fill 3D space. Someone called Steven Stadnicki found two and put them on Math Overflow. This is the one I showed you before. And you can show that this one fills space by just getting lots of copies of it. So I made a whole bunch in alternating colors just so they're easier to see. And you show that if you start clipping these together, you can build up a shape like this. I think I can get that to clip in. There we go. And if you can continue this over and, there we go, over again. There's another one there. You can build up a complete layer which is too thick and with no gaps. And so that would just like slot in there. And if you continue this, like you could continue it in that direction, there's no gaps. You can continue it in that direction, there's no gaps. And so you could just continue this as far as you want and it's a perfectly flat layer. And so then they could just stack up from there. And so you've managed to show this shape fills 3D space. Now, what O'Rourke and Diaz did was take a more complicated one, the Dali cross. And that is not quite as straightforward. First of all, they showed you can put it together into like little loops, which are nice. And then you can stack those together. And then what I've done is I've built two lots of this and they showed that the bits that stick up from one of these layers slot into the holes of the other one. And oh goodness. If I'm very careful, where are the bits? Here we go, let's see if I can do this. That should lower in there, come on. Oh, here we go, here we go. That's it. Yes! Okay, so I've managed to weave those two layers together, and you can see now some of these holes have been filled, but there's still other holes, but then there's still sticky out bits, and so you do this again. These sticky out bits of another one on top would fill those in, and these would fill those holes, and so you keep stacking these up, and they all, each one, each individual Dali cross spans three layers. And then you have them up one off the other, one off the other. And they showed, using some fantastic diagrams, that you can repeat that and there are no gaps. I wanted to find one myself. And so I found this one here, which is number 249. And I liked it because it's got like a bit of a spiral shape going on. And I realized if you rotated it through its three possible arrangements, so there it is, that orange one, is the same arrangement as the green one there. But if I then rotate this one that way, it's there, it's now the same as the yellow one. And if I rotate it again, it's now the same as the blue one. And so they're the three orientations and they join together to make this continuous spiral. And then it would repeat. So you'd put one in this orientation on the end there again, and you'd carry on as far as you want in that direction. And then these stack. So I cable tied some together before, because they kept falling apart, and show that you can just repeat this. I can add that one on that way around, like that. That would just sit in there. There you go. There's the next one on there. And so this repeats. Oh, it's a little bit loose there. So actually, I made more, of course. So you can show that this will repeat as you can go as far as you want that way. You can go as far as you want that way. And again, end to end, that is the repeating point. There, the ends are a little bit loose, but likewise, and they stack perfectly that way with no gaps. And that's kind of the process you go through to show that one of these fills space. First of all, you show that you can join a bunch of them together to make a bigger kind of repeating unit, which could be this, and then you show that repeating unit can be repeat with itself in all six directions, and then you've done it. And I did that for three of them. I found two more in here somewhere. There you are. I'll link to them below. But now the question is, hang on. If we've found seven of them, how many of these fill 3D space? That's one of the things I love about mathematics. It wasn't until the 1960s before someone even thought to think how many of these are there. We didn't work it out until the 1980s, and it was only in the last 10 years that we started to think which of these can tile 3D space. But now we're discovering some of them, and I got to do one. This one and two others are mine. I found the pattern which you repeat these to fill space. Isn't that amazing? Now there's probably two emotions running through your head right now. One of them is, I want to find one. Which of these fill 3D space, and you could find it. And your second emotion is probably just curiosity. You're thinking, hang on, which hypercube unfoldings tile space? Which is why I've started the project, which hypercube unfoldings tile space.org. Or what's.org. If you go onto that website, you can submit a tiling for any of the ones here that we do not yet know how they fill 3D space, if indeed they do. And to do that, you can send in some photos. So when I emailed O'Rourke and Diaz, I sent them a photo of like the individual one, and then I sent a photo of this one explaining how you three of these make this. And then I sent a photo of this, and then I sent some photos showing, oh, this is how I think it all goes together. And it occurred to me, well, we can all do that. And when I asked them why they didn't check if more of these fill 3D space, they were, well, they realized they'd found a couple to show what they wanted to do in their research, but there's no way they were gonna manually go and find the rest themselves, so they didn't bother. Classic mathematician. And some of these are super straightforward. That one there, I'm pretty sure that one would definitely fill 3D space. You can show that one without too much hassle. That one's probably doable just looking at it. Some of them, like this one, is gonna be more complicated. Whoops, that one's come loose. not gonna lie, some of these are pretty precarious. both mathematically and just physically up here. So they decided it wasn't worth their effort. It was only two of them working on it. But with us, literally thousands of us, surely we can check loads more. I mean, there's two outcomes here. Either we will show that every single unfolding of the 4D hypercube does tile space, that'll be amazing, or we will find some that don't, and that would be amazing. It's not gonna be quick, but we will do it eventually, and we'll keep the project going for as long as it takes. You can go on, you can submit a tiling that you found, you can volunteer to be a verifier, and there are people who will go through and look at the ones that are submitted and check if they work or not. And one day we'll have a list of all the people who discovered and indeed verified the tilings. So there you are, your piece of mathematical history. Go to whats.org and get involved. Ah, I'm so excited about this project, but there's actually one other bit of unfinished mathematical business we have to tend to. Before then, however, these are all getting a bit much. So I'm gonna take them down. This is not to say there weren't more interesting things that O'Rourke and Diaz did. They also showed that if you take the Dali cross, you can unfold it into a net, which also tiles the plane, which means a hypercube, which tiles 4D space, can be unfolded into the Dali cross, which tiles 3D space, which can be unfolded into another net that tiles 2D space. That's pretty cool. However, I was distracted by the question of what happens in the next dimension up. If you unfold a 5D cube into its 4D nets, how many of those will they be? I looked at the online encyclopedia of integer sequences and it stopped at 261. That was it. I was like, oh, maybe no one's ever worked it out. But a little bit more Googling, I came across a post again on Math Overflow from someone called Moritz Fershing, who I recognized because they are one of the people who actually did 3D model renders of all 261 of the unfoldings of the hypercube. And whenever I refer to a number of one of them, I'm using Moritz's number scheme. And that's what we're using on whats.org. So I sent Moritz an email and said, hey, you've got this post where you've pointed out that in theory, in 5D, there are 9,694 4D nets of the 5D hypercube. In 6D, it's 502,111 unfoldings. 7D is 33,064,966. And in 8D, you have calculated 2,642,657,288 unfoldings. There's over 2 billion 7D nets which fold into an 8D cube. And Moritz said that they hadn't bothered putting them on the OEIS or anywhere else because they didn't think people would be that interested. Not true, I said. I'm making a video about it. And so they went and updated the OEIS. And I was like, all right, there you are. Me making this video has caused the OEIS to be updated all the way to 8D. But then I got an email from Moritz who said, now you've made me think about this again. I've calculated the next one. So I can now announce, never before announced, that the 9D value is 248,639,631,948. Isn't that incredible? And while they were at it, Moritz then found 10D as well. 26,941,775,019,280. So there you are. And at that point, they stopped calculating anymore. And they have held back announcing those numbers until this video came out. So there you are. That was the first ever public announcement of the number of 9D nets which can fold up into a 10D cube. They're not going to try and go any further because the way we're doing this, counting all the pairings on all these ridiculous tree graphs, it's hugely inefficient. Moritz compared it to calculating factorials by counting up all the possible combinations of choosing things. Like, it's just the most grossly inefficient way of doing it. There's probably a better and smarter way of working it out, but we don't know that maths yet. Unsolved problem. If someone can crack a better way to calculate these values, that would be incredible. But for now, thanks to this video, we now know the values all the way up to the 10th dimension. Speaking of thanks, I've got two very important thank yous, which is why I put all of these back up again in exactly the same positions where they were before. Almost like I filmed this bit earlier on. So thank you so much to everyone who supports these videos. I realized when I was making all of these that I was hand numbering them. This one's number 105. This one is 138. Oh, and that one is a bit lower than it was before. That's not going to cause a continuity issue. Anyway, these are now limited edition, individually numbered models from this video. So I'm going to put all of them up on a secret link on Mass Gear. If you'd like to buy one, it'll come with a certificate I'll sign saying which number it is and then it was in the video. And all the money goes towards supporting this channel. So I will link to that below. Thank you for being the most incredible audience ever. If you can't afford to buy one, that's fine. Just thank you for watching the videos. And also huge thanks to Jane Street. So if you've ever wondered what it's like to work at a company where they use mathematics to solve complex problems in the financial world, and that pays the bills, it's okay. They have put together a series of videos from their staff. Normally they would be out visiting university campuses, doing careers fairs, going to all sorts of events, which they can't do at the moment. So they've put together a big Get to Know Us page on their website where you can watch the staff say in their own words what it's like to work at Jane Street. And of course, you can always apply for a job there if you do mention that you watch my videos and that's why you're applying. They also have paid internships. And so the details for all of that will be right at the top of the description below. Jane Street, I think they're amazing. Please do check them out. But hey, you shouldn't still be watching this video. You should have gone to whats.org by now to find out which hypercube unfoldings tile space. See you there.